Afternoon, I'm Bill Duca. Welcome to Theater 100. This is our course on television, film, and theater, an attempt to gain an appreciation of the work that goes into a work like this by the hands of actors, directors, designers, the many technical people involved in this work of television, film, and theater. So we're looking at what they do in this class. This is our seventh week here, and unfortunately, as I'm going to have to talk to my students soon. This is a midterm exam week, but we've got a great show for you today. We hope you will be able to call in. There's our toll-free number, 1-800-339-1193. Maybe you have some insights on theater of diversity or musical theater, which are the two topics that we're going to look at. Or you may want to log on with some of our students on dhtv.csudh.edu to respond to some of the things that we're asking today and focusing on. In fact, we'll give you a focus question that you might want to think about responding to right away. Today we're going to look at theater diversity first, and then we'll, in the second half, look at musical theater, which is truly an American, distinctly American form. So it's we always enjoy looking at the American musical. But let's look at theater diversity in this first half and ask the question, why and how can theater help some groups who have been traditionally discriminated against? Whereas in theater, which supposedly is entertainment, how can it help a particular group that has, in the past, not been given the same amount of equal share of that American pie? So how can theater help groups who have occasionally been discriminated against or traditionally been discriminated against? That's our question for today. So you want to think about a response to that. Again, if you want to call in and talking about that, 1-800-339-1193, or log on to our website at dhtv.csudh.edu. So today we're going to talk about multicultural theater or theater of diversity and the musical, but I just want to remind some of you who are local to try to join us for our show, Jenny Sutter. Welcome on, Jenny Sutter, which opened last weekend, sold out the whole weekend, so I'm sure that it's going to be sold out this weekend, which means that if you are interested in seeing it, you should call and make a reservation right now. I don't know if you can see the number on there. I'll read it to you. The area code is 310-243-3588. If you want to reserve a seat for Jenny Sutter, this is a wonderful play. I found it very, very interesting. We had a good 70 people sitting in the opening night there. And Cordiel Canola did a fabulous job directing. You met her on one of the broadcasts, just as you last week met Sol Guerrero, who was in the cast. Sol did a great job. I totally expected her to do that. So I was quite pleased with her performance. And this is a unique subject. It's about an Iraqi vet who is disabled from the war and trying to reorient to normal life again. In fact, she disappears to a certain extent, goes into something of a self-imposed exile before she joins her family again. So it's an interesting portrait of what goes on inside of our veterans as they reorient themselves to American life. So it's a wonderful, wonderful play. So please come out and see. Welcome home, Jenny Sutter. And this is our last weekend, so there's a Friday, Saturday night show, and a Sunday matinee. So hopefully you can make it. And the number again is 310-243-3588. All right, I'll do that to you again because we'd love for you to see it. Wonderful performance. And just some bad news for my students. This is midterm exam week. Ever since yesterday, the exam has been open and it goes until midnight this Friday. So you can take the exam at any time there. It's time, so you have an hour to do it. And if you go on to the assignment page, that's really where you work this class. You have to go to the assignment page every week. So this week is week 7, and it says, week 7, musicals, theater, and diversity. And it actually says that the exam folder is in there. And it will tell you that the chapters are chapters 1, 2, 5, 6, 7, and I even have the information if you have the 11th edition, which today we're talking about chapters 16 and 17 in our 10th edition of the Wilson Theater Experience. For those of you who have the 11th, it's chapters 18 and 19. So it's tough to work the different editions. That's why I say So go out to Numbers and look at the titles of the chapters. That's the safest way for you to handle this class if you're working on different editions. So the exam is there for you, the assignment page for this week. It's a matter of just clicking onto that folder and then taking the exam. You can use your book, that's fine. Just don't waste time using it. And there is a short essay in there, so Raising the Sun features prominently in there as well. So be sure you've read the play, and that'll enable you to answer this short, just asking you 5 or 6, like a paragraph on Raising the Sun. So I think, based on what I've read in terms of the discussion board postings, I'm sorry, not the discussion board postings, but the actual Raising the Sun character analysis, you all have a good understanding of the play. So I don't think it'll be a problem your essay for the exam. So anyway, get that done this week, and we'll be up to date with you then for all the assignments. Okay. Let's talk a little bit. As you know, I like to talk a little bit of history before we get into our focus area. In fact, theater of diversity, it's interesting to look at what was happening in the Renaissance theaters of France and Spain, because there you're going to find what's called the Age of Absolutism. And it's interesting that we are going to look at two kings, Louis XIV of France and Philip II of Spain, and how they ruled with such absolute power. But they both used theater to glorify in that power. And to some extent, not that they invented it, but the idea of using theater to acknowledge the valuable empire that this great leader has created has always been used. So theater, in some way, does grace the monarchs, does satisfy a certain need to glorify in our leaders. But strange enough, we'll see in theater of diversity that there is power that transfers to the classes as well. So I guess my point is, to go onto a stage and to act out plays is a political act. It is an expression of power. And this guy, Louis XIV of France, this is an amazing painting by Hugo that goes back to his era, which is the 1660s, 1670s. Louis was a fashion genius. He loved to dress the part. And of course, at that time, men wore powder wigs and lace and dozen hose. To some extent, he was not doing anything different, but he did it in a much more outrageously exaggerated, look-at-me kind of focus. In fact, there's a story about how Louis would, if you're fortunate enough, you could be invited to come to his bedroom in the morning and watch what was basically a ritual to dress him that took maybe 2-3 hours to do. It was like watching a religious figure being enshrined in some robe with some wonderful prop to show his scepter. To some extent, you were part of an inner circle if you could watch Louis get dressed in the morning. Right? But he called himself the Sun King, and he wanted to reflect his power over everything. And it's very interesting that when he builds Versailles, he even has the bushes and all the trees kind of landscaped to look like geometric figures. I don't know if anyone's ever been fortunate enough to go to Versailles, which is a beautiful palatial territory outside of Paris. But it is a show that Louis wanted to do to show that he was even the lord of nature. He could actually shape nature himself. So order was very much what Louis wanted to establish. And it's funny that even writing a play at that time, Louis and Michelot and a number of other ministers had called to force what was called the French Academy. These were scholars who worked on how to write a great play. Almost every culture has tried to come up with some system for the arts. We'll talk about the well-made play in the 19th century. But here in the 17th century, the attempt by the French Academy was to create what later became known as the neoclassical ideal. It began in Italy, but when it transferred to France, they just loved the idea that a play should have three unities. A unity of time should only happen in 24 hours. A unity of place should take place in one basic place, a palace, and should be one action. You straightforward plots like Shakespeare did. When you're writing plays, you follow one specific line. So that was part of the order. And many great playwrights of the time, Corneille, Racine, and even Molière, conformed to this neoclassical ideal. The plays were done in beautiful, extravagant houses. This is the Palais Royal, which was 1641, this is before Molière's time. But this shows the kind of elegance of going to the theater, the use of beautiful perspective painted scenery that had been created in Italy, but then transferred all over Europe. The French loved those new classical forms, both in terms of how the play had to be written and how it had to be visualized to look very elegant and absolutely majestic, because, I don't know if you can see in the picture there, but the king is sitting in the one bottom seat, right? This is our king, right down here, down center. And he's the one who gets the beautiful perspective painting effect. So it would be off if you were having to watch from the sides here. But here's our king, and he would definitely get the best view of all. So interesting how grandiose theater became in the hands of Louis XIV. And let's just watch a little clip to give you an example of what the kind of theater that was viewed then was about. And Molière is an interesting playwright because a lot of what Molière did was look around him and see absolute hypocrisy. So he wanted to make fun of those who were parading themselves. And some say that Molière himself was mocking Louis the King, to some extent mocking the aristocracy. And it is really in Molière's hands that the comedy of matters becomes perfected. That all goes back to Aristophanes, and other writers have written it. We'll see Oscar Wilde use it at the end of the 19th century. Molière does it beautifully, and many of the English playwrights of the Restoration will copy him. But this is a little clip from I think you'll enjoy this. It shows a man who feels that we should be honest with everyone and not hold anything back. Now, you tell me if this man seems like a fool, or since it is the role that Molière would play in the production of The Misanthrope, or whether he is the hero of the play. So this is a little clip from The Misanthrope by Molière. Thank you. or as his friend Flint is saying, Flint is something of the foil of the play because he's more of the rational voice, whereas Alcest, the central character, which Molière would have played in the production, he's a little exaggerated in his enthusiasm, and Flint's side would say, you have to compromise in life, you can't tell people the absolute truth, we have enemies all around us. So he makes the compromises that we all have to make to get along with people in our governments, our families, our schools. So yeah, he has a much more realistic voice, Flint, which is a great character as well. So Molière's plays were always mocking social absurdity. In fact, it was Molière who said that the true goal of comedy is to correct social ills, kind of heal society, not just by making us laugh, but by letting us see how we are being hypocritical. So, very interesting play. I mean, he had very many plays that were quite successful and are still done. French love Molière. The Comédie Française is always doing Molière. So, probably the greatest comic playwright in the world. The French will tell you that, and it was Shakespeare. So hopefully you'll get to see a Molière play someday. Interestingly enough, right across the way in Spain, the same thing was going on. Here we had Philip II of Spain by 1556. He had amassed the most powerful nation in the world. Spain controlled most of the Americas at that time, the Philippines, Italy, possessions in Asia, Africa. If it wasn't for the Battle of the Armada, 1588, still all be speaking Spanish. So they were a very powerful country, especially with the way that they conquered Mexico and Peru and took so much wealth from the New World. The Inquisition was there to guarantee absolute obedience from everyone. There was almost a kind of medieval times hold over people's minds that the church still had. And really, if you consider the fact that there were there where Islam controlled Spain, and when Ferdinand and Isabel finally got rid of the Jews and the Moors, I mean, there's a good expression of kind of order that an absolutist king wanted to have, the expulsion of Moors and the Jews from Spain, it was truly an act of ethnic cleansing. And with that went any freedom for women were pretty much kept in seclusion in Spain. In fact, if they went to the theater, they had a special place called the Pasadena where women were allowed to stay to watch the show. So, I mean, that's kind of interesting that they were free to go to whatever seat they wanted. And this obsession with order, which we saw in France, which is there in Spain, is very much an expression of how powerful theater can be. That to go on stage and to act means to perhaps say that you have a certain amount of power. So the way that these absolutist kings used theater to make themselves even grander. And a lot of what Philip II of Spain was doing was religious plays that reasserted the dominance of the Catholic Church in Spain, which would stay pretty much continuous through to the end of the 18th century. And isn't it interesting, though, that in this time, which demanded such religious obsession, it was a very fundamentalist time for Spain, that the most popular play that comes out of it is Tirso de Molina's The Trickster of Seville, which in 1616 was the first play that features the character Don Juan. Now, Don Juan is going to live on in over 250 plays. Mozart writes an opera of him, George Bernard Shaw writes a version. There are many, many, many different takes on this. You may have seen some movies, for instance, that feature that same character. In fact, many believe that the Dracula concept, the idea of someone who has this hypnotic power over women, is basically the Don Juan character. So this obsession with order and honor and women makes this play about this grand lover, this trickster, that's the original name of the play, The Trickster of Seville. So, and shows enough this picture of Tirso de Molina, the playwright. He was a monk. And when he writes this play, he's going to be exiled for it. So interesting that there was perhaps a little bit of a political statement there by this monk who wrote this famous player of Don Juan. So interesting that these two very absolutist eras should somehow reflect what's going on in theater of diversity, because now we have today, thankfully, a freedom that theater can express power that has come to all peoples. I'm not saying everything is equal just yet, there's a way to go yet, but it has changed enormously from these Renaissance times when only the kings had the absolute control of the stages. Not that there wasn't shows being done outside, and we talked a little bit about Canadian art, for instance, but to some extent, the power really laid in the hands of the aristocracy here. But in theater of diversity, we have a new change. In fact, that's our question for today. We are asking you to look at how theater can help a certain group that has traditionally been discriminated against. And I see we already have some students responding to this question. I see Natasha Weber was the first one to respond. So let's see some of our students are saying about our focus question today. Acacia is saying, theater can give those who are discriminated against a voice. Through acting, they can show their discontent with the discrimination placed upon them. And thank you, Acacia. I mean, that is very much what we're going to look at with theater of diversity. Strangely enough, the history of American theater features a growing concern with the minority experience. As the immigrants began coming in the middle of the 19th century with German, Asian, specifically Chinese at first, Italians, we get a number of plays that feature a focus on particular ethnic groups. Now, a lot of it was just based on New York marketing. Let's write a play that will appeal to the Irish and bring them into the theaters in the 19th century. We're talking about theaters that could hold over 3,000 people. They were working class theaters. So the idea of marketing particular groups is not a new one today. Hollywood didn't think that up. That goes back to the 19th century. And by the time we get to the 20th century, there are flourishing theaters in Harlem for African Americans. There's a New York Jewish theater that appeals to the Jewish peoples, and all throughout this territory, from San Francisco all the way to Texas, there's a vibrant, very vibrant Southwest theater that is all Spanish-speaking. Okay, it's not covered in the English-speaking papers, but there are. In fact, by 1920, Los Angeles becomes the center hub of Mexican-American playwriting. So there was a lot of great developments there, but we'll see that when we even look at the great American playwrights, O'Neill, Miller, Williams, they're really responding to a lot of the same things that you look at with Lorraine Hansberry or Lillian Hellman or Luis Valdez, a statement against oppression. And that's exactly the issue we just mentioned, that the that theater is, to some extent, theater diversity has given theater a new definition, because we're seeing people who have gone through some terrible experience of oppression now having a voice to be able to speak out against it. So thank you, Acacia, for pointing that out. And I think we've got a comment here from Matthew as well. Thank you, Matthew. Matthew's saying it can be a means for people to spread ideas and messages through an artistic medium. And that is, you know, the power really is in the medium to have that ability to communicate with large audiences, and obviously now, you know, on the internet and movies, but even in the 19th century, it was quite powerful to be able to send your message through a piece of theater. It's hard to kind of recognize that what the world could have been like when there was only the medium of theater, and you couldn't even turn on a radio or make a telephone call. So obviously theater had great power to give oppressed groups some kind of a voice there. And here's what it said. Saying, theater can attempt to show the effects of discrimination from the victim's point of view and possibly show the discriminator learning a lesson. So, we are giving the victim a chance to express what their experience was. After all, what makes for a good piece of theater the conflict? So if we're talking about real experiences that people have gone through above that oppression, it fits right into what good theater should be about. Here's Cynthia Lewis using our Raisin example. Thank you, Cynthia. Raisin is an excellent example of a group that had been discriminated against and chose to stand up to this adversity. And our students, for those of you who are not students and are watching, they just recently read Raisin in the Sun and wrote about it. So there's a perfect example of a kind of power that will come to a particular group. In fact, that story is about moving into a white neighborhood, and it has a political act there. So to some extent, having to be able to see that on stage gives hope to not just Black Americans, but to white Americans to see some kind of social equality developing. This was 1959, right there in the heart of the civil rights movement. So thank you, Cynthia. That's a great example of what we mean by giving some power to these groups who have been traditionally discriminated against. Okay. I'll look a little bit of some of the experiences that different groups have gone through. You know, your chapter 16 in Wilson is just one few good. It's full of details about particular performers, playwrights. It's very specific writing. It's an example of someone who writes with specificity. It's not generalized. So I hope when you read Wilson, you don't read it just for the content, but read for the style as well, and perspective. You know, just, I'm looking at the 10th of this year. There's such great images here, like this wonderful image of the Black man with a noose around his neck in Gem of the Ocean by August Wilson. I mean, this is a playwright writing about the experience that African Americans have had. And if you really look at the history for African Americans, the plantations actually became something of a showcase. Many of the plantation masters would encourage their slaves to perform on weekends, and actually divided the South and created a lot of animosity because many whites who did not have slaves did not like that. But these plantation entertainments provided, in a way, a kind of caricature of African Americans that lived on, especially when white performers, and now we're talking about the 1820s, 1830s, when white performers like Thomas Rice would blacken up their face. There's a great image of the Christie minstrels. Blacken up their face and make their lips enormously red and portray a kind of caricature of a plantation African American with exaggerated ways of talking, what later became known as the Negro dialect, with a very shuffling, kind of lazy characterization. And these images of what became known as Jim Crow, that's what Thomas Rice portrayed, became the center of the minstrel shows. And the minstrel shows that grew out of the Jim Crow caricature were a horrible portion of African Americans, caricatures of African Americans by white performers, where they would sit in a semicircle of like 15 blackface individuals. And they would, I mean, the show would be entertaining because it's music and it's dance and it's vignettes, scenes, monologues. I mean, it was a show, and these shows were just playing the South. They played all over America. They traveled to England, they went to Europe. The minstrel show became popular. They were very popular, the Percy Minstrels, the Virginia Minstrels. There were a number of different groups that that helped to develop a very gross stereotype of African Americans. And once we even went into the 20th century, a lot of that minstrel tendency filtered into radio, filtered into television. You could watch in 1970, what was called the Black and White Minstrel Show. So it's amazing how these gross stereotypes developed out. Realized that there were many attempts by African Americans to correct them, beginning with the African Grove Theater, 1820. This played for about 6 or 7 years in the Village area of New York City. Interestingly enough, it was finally brought down by whites who went there to kind of disrupt the performances. And one of the famous actors, Ira Aldridge, though, came out of the African Grove and actually went to England and became a famous star. Traveled all over Europe, performed in Russia, and became most popular for his performance as a fellow, but he played many other roles as well. Never returned to America. So greatest performers of the 19th century, never returned. But that tells you a lot about the situations in the 19th century. But it wasn't until the Harlem Renaissance and performers like Bert Williams that we get a break in this harsh caricature. And then Marcus Garvey, at the beginning of the Harlem Renaissance, is actually calling for more authentic portrayals of blacks by blacks. That's what the Harlem Renaissance really is. People like Sterling and Hurston and Langston Hughes writing plays and novels and stories that are much more authentic and not these stereotypes. And there's a lot of plays written. I mean, before 1940, there were a good 350 African American plays written, half of whom were written by women. I mean, it's an interesting factor here, too, that there were many women like Mae Miller, George Douglas, who wrote plays to try to respond to some of the injustices that were happening racially for African Americans. And they were doing these plays in church halls, and they weren't going to Broadway, but they were conducting a vibrant debate about race in America. So finally, once we get to Maria Hansberry, I mean, many others had the foundation for what became the explosion of Raising the Sun, and then the resultant explosion of the 60s, because we get some very angry voices throughout the 1960s in America, Baraka, and Tiffany Shankly, who writes for Color Girls, which is a wonderful, wonderful play that was complained by black women about being oppressed by not just race, not just gender, but also by class. So that triple oppression was the source of what Tiffany Shankly was writing about. And probably one of the greatest writers of the 20th century has to be August Wilson. August Wilson, who's only recently passed away in the last couple of years, Wilson decided to write a poem to stand for each decade of the African-American experience of the 20th century. And he did. He wrote 10 plays that each one represents a different decade of the experience of Java the Ocean in your book, in the 10th edition at least, is one of them. But Fences, Piano Lesson, Joe Turner's Young Gun, these are wonderful plays that are filled with storytelling that really document the African American experience. So, very, very strong playwright. Well, there are many, many African Americans writing right now. In fact, the Pulitzer Prize just went to Lynn Nottage, who wrote a beautiful play called Intimate Power, but she wrote a play called Ruin about the sex trade that is happening in the Congo in Africa. And it was a wonderful performance on Broadway, just won the Pulitzer. So African American players are doing very well right now, and it's been quite a journey. And to some extent, it patterns what many other groups have taken as well. If we look at Asian American theater, we'll see a similar development. The three waves of Asian American immigration left us with, strangely enough, by 1950, a kind of strange stereotyping of Asian Americans as wise old men, or spies, or cooks, or submissive, the China doll. These were promoted by white playwrights all across America, and the Asian communities were performing their own works at the time within the little Tokyos or wherever they were segregated by that society. But it wasn't until the 1960s that we start getting a protest. To some extent, there were four groups that were created, like the East-West Players out here and Pan-Asian Rep in New York, many others, I should just say four, who wanted to portray Asian Americans with some authenticity, very similar to what was happening in the Harlem Renaissance. So we get writers like Philip Gondotonda, who writes a play like The Wash, which is about how difficult it is for Japanese Americans to assimilate into American society. David Henry Lang, who writes writes Golden Child, which is about how Christianity came into China beginning of the 19th century. And obviously his most famous play, Butterfly, which is an attempt to correct the Western stereotype that we hold of Asian women as being submissive. So a lot of these plays were written in an attempt to react against the stereotyping that was being done for Asians. And even events like the Simon on the controversy when a white actor was given a role on Broadway that featured them wearing slant eyes and yellow makeup. Well, to many of the actors in the Asian American community, this was no different than blackface. In fact, they called it yellowface. They basically said yellowface is wrong. So there's been a lot of political action by the Asian American communities and actors in a similar way. Hispanic American theater, if you look at the long history of that, we also see a similar pattern. Now, there had always been a great amount of theater in the Mesoamerican world. Aztec and Mayan ritual was very pronounced. There were plays that were written. But when the conquistadors come in with the friars next to them, a lot of these plays were destroyed. It was an attempt to appease the Mesoamericans' religious thought with Christianity. And colonial theater was done in a very, very manipulative way to teach the stories of the Bible. And that continued for many centuries. And it wasn't until the 1960s that we get an interesting political movement. Cesar Chavez now is able to develop the Great Strike in the Central Valley of California with the help of things like television. Now we have television. He actually has priests who are joining the huelga, the strike. He has students coming up from USC or UCLA. But he also has Luis Valdez, who brings a unique tool, which is theater. And Chicano theater really did grow out of these experiments almost. And you see Luis Valdez on the side, and he's prepping these two actors who are workers, farm workers. And he puts a sign on them. And one is the Patroncito, the little boss. And the other one is the Amiga. And these signs are basically all that is given them for characters, except for the use of some masks occasionally. And what Valdez would do is ask them to improvise, make up their lines as they go along. Well, out of that idea came Teatro Campesino, the idea of farm workers doing plays that showed the injustices that they were suffering. And it started a whole movement of teatros all over the country that may not have anything to do with farm working, may have something to do with your landlord. So this idea of using theater to express your opposition became very central to Hispanic American theater. And writers like Octavio Sinis and Sherry Moraga, who wrote a beautiful play, Heroes and Saints, that was very much about similar oppression for farm workers. But Valdez and Susut, these are plays, Dipe Real, who writes about the Latina experience, these are plays that are very much reactions against the problems of race for Latinos in Native America today. So again, the idea of responding to what you're experiencing becomes a great American tool. Let's hear a little bit about what our students are saying, because we've asked this question. I know we have a number of them who've written some interesting comments. Let's take a look at this before we take our break here. But Daniela is saying that oppressed groups have the opportunity of bringing awareness and giving insight as to the obstacles and prejudices they face differently. And a lot of those perceptions, Daniela, you're right, are you could not have unless you were that particular person. So if you are a woman who no longer, who doesn't have the right to vote at the turn of the 20th century, then it makes sense for you if you are someone like some of the great writers, like Anna Corr-Boas or Susan Glasgow, to write about these issues that seem so unfair. A white author, a white male author is not going to take that side, so you need those perspectives to be able to make that statement. So thanks, Daniel, that was great. Judy is also responding to our question here about how theater can help some groups who have been traditionally discriminated against to develop a political action. Judy's saying that theater can help groups that have been discriminated against by telling their story, giving their perspective on the discrimination. It begins with a storytelling, Judy. I agree with you. And to some extent, the ability to tell a story sounds so simple, sounds so innocent. But it has to do with establishing some sense of power that I feel that you are going to listen to what values my culture believes in. So it really is an attempt at cross cross-cultural understanding as soon as we start telling our stories. So that's very good culture. There's so much to talk about. I can talk about the American theater, which is usually so ritualistically bound. It's very interesting to watch how that connection has stayed so strong. Even in plays by Hanna Gigola, who was a student here in the 70s, who began writing very interesting plays about the Native American experience. Spider Woman, which is a feminist Native American group that provoked a lot of these kind of ritually based storytelling, very much driven by storytelling types of theater. And there's women's theater, feminist theater, which deserves a whole semester. I mean, gosh, if you look at the whole history of how women were not allowed on stage for so many centuries, and how even when they were, people like Roswitha, who was a 10th century nun who wrote plays according to the Roman ideals, Isabella Andreini, famous commedia dell'arte performer, Aphrodite from the Restoration Age, future scholars tried to discredit these women and say that they never existed. So, and now, thanks to a lot of feminist scholars, we have unearthed many of the works that these writers had done. But there are many modern women writers, from Martha Norman to Beth Henley, to Eva Esther, who wrote the Vagina Monologues, who are writing about exactly what our students have been talking about, some of the oppression that has been just unacceptable to the point where you have to go to the streets, just as the suffragettes went to the streets, to earn the right for vote. And that took longer than just the 10 years leading up to 1920, because that had begun back in the 19th century. So these are long battles, and very much the civil rights movement is perhaps a perfect pattern to show how many groups had to fight for not just vote, but the chance to go on stage and represent themselves authentically. Okay, it's a wonderful chapter. I hope you all dig into it further, but we're going to take a little break here and come back and look at musical theater. In fact, just to get your ideas rolling, let's ask this question. Have you ever seen a musical on stage? I'd be very curious to hear from you if there's any musical that you've seen live performance of a musical on stage, musical, and what did you think? I was stood out about it now. I know that a lot of you haven't seen on-stage work, so in case you haven't, maybe there was a musical film that you saw that you enjoyed, so you could write about that too. But let's talk about musicals when we come back, and I'll be curious to hear from you what was your best experience of seeing a musical. All right, so look forward to you after the break to talk about musical theater.
Hey, what's up? I'm Nicole Aaron.
And I'm Shane. You guys are watching University TV.
California State University, the biggest
in the world of the tour of the Science Campus Tour. The four clubs sit on the Cal State Campus Hills campus. It's on 346 acres. We're running 21 places to study or lounge outside and enjoy the California weather. And all buildings are only a short walking distance from one another. You'll also find pedestrian paths lined by eucalyptus or shade trees. Now, this is called on the hill. The campus makes good use of the tree, with many buildings built at varying elevations. The campus is made of the segments from the most buildings and bridge walkways to find a seamless connection.
To take a social recently, you must want to see the seamless. It's amazing histories of beautiful campus that we learn very much.
This university enrolls about 12,000 students per semester and is one of the most ethnically and culturally rich student bodies in the U.S. No one ethnic group on campus is in the majority. The student body is 70% female to 30% male.
So, after graduating, I had to be offered to visit the school and visit the year from the teacher and have a new professor and a teacher program for the children to talk to the academy system. And that's one of the main things that we need to do.
So far, students have considered GPA requirement. People are sponsored with SAT or ACT, so people higher than GPA. And last week we promised all the girls and we go to try everything safe.
Scans and GPS meter tuner are non-eligible for admission.
For California residents, the average full-time agency in Solar Canvas is $3,400. Not including the cost of books and housing.
State students get about $400 extra per unit.
The university offers many financial aid options, including scholarships and grants.
Additional state's biggest institution for choice of 45 bachelor's and 21 master's degrees and 10 teaching credits and certificate programs.
We are planning a project for our investigations of how students are doing their development algorithms. Teachers will relate to thereby shipping conditions, schools, such as so forth.
Some of the students' favorite majors include visual studies, business administration, digital media arts, child development, and nursing.
Want to work in television or the motion picture and music industries? Ball State Jacksonville's digital media arts program seeks to find out their students from careers in those fields.
The legend holds true. There's a ghost in every theater. When the famous hill spirit comes to every play, opens the elevator doors, and wishes the cast good luck.
The university also holds a master's degree program in conflict resolution and peace building. Ball State or Five's prosthetics program is one of only 7 such programs in the nation.
With 687 faculty members, the university's student-to-faculty ratio of 23:1.
The university has 11 men and women's girls athletic teams, which compete at the NCAA Division II level.
The doors hold 3 conference titles and 3 national championships.
Bill DeLuca back here at Theater 100. Thanks for coming back. We have the American musical to look at for the second half, which is always exciting to deal with. This is a truly unique American form. You won't find this anywhere else in the world, and some say this is the one great contribution that America has to the theater arts, is the musical. So, looking forward to following this with my students. In fact, I've asked them any of them have seen a musical that they particularly enjoy. So that's our focus question. Feel free to respond to it if you'd like. You can call in at that toll-free number 1-800-339-1193 and tell us about some musical that you saw that was just fabulous, why you thought it was so fabulous. Well, you may want to log on and see Matthew Jones has done that to dhtv.csudh.edu, and we'll read some of your comments on what was particularly interesting about the musical that you may have seen. And even if you haven't seen it live, you saw a film, you can talk about that too. But the origins of the American musical are kind of unique because it's a lot of mysterious. It's not like it came from one definite place. It's a combination of many things, obviously. First of all, there was opera, which we have to admit, you know, was the source of theater on stage with Saint, and out of those same areas where we were just looking at Louis XIV came this idea of recreating Greek drama. Well, with the Renaissance scholars did was mistakenly create opera, which became very, very popular in Italy, in France, all over Europe, and then obviously to all the West, because it featured a play that was sung the entire time, even if it's done with recitative where they're saying lines, but they're elevating it in terms of the language to a kind of sing song, it's still considered opera. And opera requires grandiose sense, so that whole Italian ideal was dynamic for many of these theaters. By the time we get to the 19th century, we now have plays in France that feature music behind them, and this becomes known as melodrama and grows also into great spectacle, especially in the hands of American directors at the end of the 19th century, bringing in the impact of the Industrial Revolution to their work, so that you can watch avalanches on stage, and you can watch great moments of spectacle. We still love what melodrama can bring to our theater. One of the most unique influences that many African American scholars believe is not given its due is the minstrel show. The same minstrel shows I was just talking about had developed what later became known as the bolero. The second act of the minstrel shows were very much similar to vaudeville, which was the idea of different entertainers would come up and do different skits. It was like you saw one playing in the course of the evening. You saw many different, a variety of entertainments. It's like cable television now as you're searching through channels, right? But that's the essence of vaudeville. So the minstrel show, supposedly when you would have this whole chorus line of girls dancing around performing like Bert Williams, you were starting to move towards the American musical, and vaudeville did a great deal to develop that, as well as burlesque, which in the 20th century, we know burlesque has a form where women take off their clothes on stage, but the original burlesques of the 19th century were basically satirical plays that were written to kind of mock a great classic. So there would be burlesques of Hamlet, where you got to kind of laugh at Hamlet making mistakes throughout the production. But burlesque inevitably did devolve into a girly show to some extent. But there was a lot of music involved in that. So opera, melodrama, the minstrel shows. There were plays in the 19th century, like The Black Cook, that became fabulous entertainments, which is kind of an odd story. I think Wilson talks a little bit about it in the book. This French ballet company lost the right to their theater, so there was another play that was going on, and they combined them together, and it became this musical extravaganza, The Black Crook, and that had a lot of impact on future plays that wanted to have a musical quality as well. But we really begin to talk about musical comedy when we look at the early 20th century and the works of great performers slash composers like George M. Cohan, Jerome Kern, Barry Berlin, Cole Porter, Richard Rogers, Jerome Kern, Oscar Hammerstein. So by 1927, when we see Showboat, we're now getting the real pattern of an idea of a play that is organic in terms of it following the storyline, but there are occasional songs in and out of it, like Showboat, which features a song of Old Man River, some of the great actors like Paul Robeson. It's got to win people's hearts. look at one of the earliest examples. It actually wasn't so early. Rogers and Hammerstein combined together with Agnes DeMille on a production of Oklahoma. Now, Oklahoma, to some extent, kind of bonded together a lot of the influences that had been developing there in the early 20th century. So that by the time we get to the 1940s, we now get a whole concept of a book that is the storyline. Okay, you have someone who wrote the lines that the actors say, right? So, and then you might have someone different writing the lyrics. And these are the words of songs, as well as the different composers writing the music for the song. So, to some extent, you're getting a variety of artists. And when you had a choreographer like Agnes DeMille, who was a trained ballet performer, you get a kind of larger-than-life performance from the actors. And I think you see in this cut from Oklahoma that, yes, it's done with a Western theme, for sure, in the costumes, but notice how the dancing has a kind of ballet quality, and it gives, to some extent, us a pattern for what would happen in the 1950s as the golden age of the American musical. To some extent, Oklahoma perhaps set up as a pattern to follow. So here's a little clip from Oklahoma.
Singers' voices kept cracking, going off key. It was priceless. Well,
policy, sometimes you can enjoy how they don't reach the notes that hopefully are going to reach. But, you know, seeing a show in a community theater is a terrific thing to do. In fact, there's many community theaters who are doing excellent work. Places like Long Beach Studio Theater or the Long Beach Community, they have two theaters there. They have a lot of very, very good actors and draw from a wide range of actors as well. So consider that as you're looking for a play to write for your play review. It doesn't have to be a professional theater, which are very expensive. It could be a community theater. It could be an educational piece at a local school or a high school. Production of Grease, it's always worth seeing. So thanks, Simon. Thank you for your observations. Hope made that an interesting experience for you. And I see Cynthia Lewis is back. Cynthia, what did you see? I had the opportunity to see the musical Cats. Fantastic. I enjoyed the dancing costumes. However, I had trouble following the storyline. Well, understandably, because Cats is a very unique play. We'll talk about that in a little bit too, but I might as well mention. Here's a musical that was created out of a poem. It is, there's no book as traditionally you have, you know, a storyline. So, Edna Ferber writes a novel, Showboat, about, you know, black life in the South. Well, then along comes, you know, the playwrights to write a play version of it. But in this case, T.S. Eliot writes a poem, and we now get a version of a play that does not really have a storyline. You're looking at the lives of these individual cats, and you're drawing from the poetry of Eliot. So it was a unique musical. I'm saying, Cynthia, is that it's understandable why perhaps you couldn't follow the plot, because it was based on something that was an unusual choice to base a musical on. And that's what perhaps contributes to its strength. It was such a unique choice to use. All right, let's see what Glass has seen. Thank you, Glass. Glass is saying, I saw a nice musical movie once. It wasn't like those annoying movies that they just sing and sing. It actually had a meaning. It was interesting. I think it was called The Sound of Music. Well, sounds like you probably did watch The Sound of Music, because there's a unique story in terms of relationships there. A whole family who's lost their mother, and the father has kind of taken over in his military role. Perhaps, you know, his role in the Austrian military did not allow him to change when he now becomes the only parent in the household. So he runs his family like a military operation. Well, of course, briefly, Andrew's into this situation. And we're now going to get a more balanced handling of these kids' lives. So there's a lot of interesting storyline behind something like The Sound of Music, though you think it's a lot of singing, you know, and dancing. But there's something compelling behind it. That's not there. It's not going to work as a musical. Let's look at some other examples here, too. Another unique subject for a musical would certainly have to be a Greek myth. Now, George Bernard Shaw took the famous Pygmalion myth and made it into a play. This is the beginning of the 19th century. But Lerner and Lowe decided, let's take Shaw's Pygmalion and make it into a musical. And they surely did. My Fair Lady is a unique piece of work. You'll see Audrey Hepburn here with her voice being dubbed by Marty Nixon, who was an actress here, who did many dubbings of voices for shows. But notice some of the humor and some of the wonderful language that is used. This is a musical about language when we look at My Fair Lady.
I know your headaches. I know you're tired. I know your nerves are as raw as meat in a butcher's window. But think what you're trying to accomplish. Just think what you're dealing with. The majesty and grandeur of the English language is the greatest possession we have. The noblest thoughts ever thrown from the hearts of men are contained in its extraordinary, imaginative, and musical mixtures of sounds. And that's what you set yourself out to conquer, Eliza.
mistake rather than what the cinematographer is choosing to show you, but to see an entire stage filled with performers, and then to see how one voice is singing here and then another voice sings there, it's larger than life. Even though our movie screen is just as large, it doesn't have the same appeal in terms of epic sense. Matthew is referring to in terms of Pink Floyd, an epic sense is something that's almost reserved, perhaps for live theater. So I like your observation. I'd be curious to know what more you might want to add about the atmosphere of Fiddler on the Roof. Again, another great musical that had a very dark story there in terms of what that was about, the Russian Jews and their oppression at the beginning of the 20th century. Yeah, very good, Judy. Thank you. You know, the musical, though, by the mid-50s, late-50s, began to change a little bit, and once we get to the 60s, it's certainly going to change. In fact, we can almost look at 1960 as a major transition. When people go to see West Side Story, they're seeing not just the famous story of Romeo and Juliet, but they're seeing it done in a very contemporary way. We're seeing it told from a gang world. Okay, where we have, yes, the Jets and the Sharks, and the wonderful choreography that was developed there, but we're seeing something that is highly relevant. So, you know, what we're seeing Sondheim writing about, and the fabulous, masterful handling of the stage. It's entertaining, but at the same time, West Side Story is such a powerful, powerful show. And again, you're looking at a fight where people die on stage. It is very much about the problems of our society today. But quite beautiful music, quite wonderful performers. You're looking to see a live performance of West Side Story that really works. And that changed things in a big way. Sondheim's influence on musicals was strong, but that itself announced something new. Fiddler on the Roof, you know, that was mid-60s, that was still kind of the same pattern that we had seen from coming from Oklahoma, but you know, once Sondheim gets in there, we're going in a very, very different direction, especially when we see shows like Sweeney Todd, or shows like here. At the end of the 60s, we see a musical that hardly has any story. It's vignettes of the experiences of this crew of oppressed youngsters who are speaking out against Vietnam, speaking out against racial oppression. I mean, it really is a mixture of theater of diversity and American theater, but simply music and very, very powerful performances. So here in 1968, with a nude scene, with a cast nude on stage, McDermott and Dragney did was truly innovative. People had seen it just because it was so new and so unique. But it did start opening those same voices we were just referring to for all peoples. So it had a rather magnetic impact on shows that later came in, like The Wiz, many popular shows created a whole new kind of perspective. Beat Misbehavin' is a great example, for instance. This was a unique musical that came out of the music of Fats Waller, kind of almost a revisit of the Harlem Renaissance to some extent, and the performances are fabulous. So to be able to go on, you can't forget what a musical really has to offer in the way of great performances, and I think you'll agree that this little clip from Misbehavin' is a great example. We have a Misbehavin' video clip, but I don't know, do we have Jelly Last Jam? That's also an interesting play that came out of a similar movement. General Martin was a famous jazz composer, 1920s, and he became very popular as we moved into the 60s and 70s, and George C. Wolfe, who, the unique director, actually ends up taking the public theater for many years after Joe Papp. George C. Wolfe creates a play that is basically a chorus kind of play, or similar perhaps in the way of what Intersection Shotgun did with For Colored Girls, where you have seven girls on stage and they would be there throughout the whole play, and they would be talking, singing, expressing some of their own poetry. You were watching a choral poem, is actually what that was called. Jesus Jam, very similar as well. Here we have a story that is basically different stories that are told by George C. Wolfe. But I think when we get this clip, I'll show you it's a very unique performance. But let me first get Oscar's comment here. We're asking the students today, have you seen anything interesting in the world of musicals? Live musicals, always great to see, but if you haven't seen something live, we're happy to look at something maybe that you've seen on film. So maybe you've seen a musical film, maybe you saw the Grease film, or two of them. What do you think makes that a unique piece? What stood out to you? What was your thrill in seeing that musical? All right, so let's see what Oscar's got to say to us. Would it be considered a play if it has interaction with the audience? Very interesting comment, Oscar. X giving compliments, asking questions, or asking questions. I'm not sure about that comment, but would it be a play? Absolutely. In fact, Hair is a perfect example of a play musical that comes right out into an audience. If you look at Lion King today, the creatures actually come right through the audience. So the idea of interacting with the audience is actually called Eastern. It's interesting you bring this up, Oscar, because Eastern theaters often focused on performing straight out to the audience. They do not have the same fascination that we have with realism, which turns characters facing each other so that it's almost like you don't exist in the audience. We're just up here ourselves, and you're kind of like a voyeur watching what's happening up here, but we never acknowledge you. Asian theater was very much played straight out. I think I showed you a little clip of Chinese opera, where all performers, even if it was a gymnast or a singer or an actor, were straight out. So I would consider it still a play. I mean, it's a play that's driven perhaps by a social message to try to bring out an audience, but it definitely is a play. In fact, if you look at the original Greek plays, Oscar, the Greek actors would play straight out to the audience, not they would get verbal responses back, but it was almost designed to get a response. Thank you, Oscar. That was pretty good. Let's see. I've got a phone call here, so let's see who we have on the line. Oh, Tony, thank you for calling.
Yes, I had a comment, and I guess it turned into a question.
Good.
So,
is this a comment on the musical? Did you see a musical that you want to share with us?
Is there a musical? It was on film.
That's it.
Excuse me. It was called It's a Wonderful Life. And this musical was... It was about... Basically about Jewish people being interned in the concentration camp in Germany. But it was done in musical fashion, which was kind of ironic to the theme of the movie, being that it was kind of a sad theme. But I specifically remember that movie as being one that was a musical on film.
Tony, did you actually call it a Wonderful Life? I mean, this famous Frank Capra movie that was made in 1946
right,
with Jimmy Stewart, is it that same title?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Really? But it's about the Jewish experience in terms of the concentration camps. I don't know if that's in this way. I've not heard of it, so, but it is a musical. Is that right? It's a musical? Did we lose Tony? Oh, okay, sorry, we're having some technical difficulties, but I'm sure we'll get Tony back. But, it's a unique thing to try to look at how musicals have changed over the year. And, if I could show you, for since Chubby's last GM, that would be a great insight for you. Because notice what happens. I don't know if you've had the pleasure of seeing some great tap dancing, but I think you'll recognize the performer who's dancing here. And if you've ever had the chance to see him live, it's a great opportunity. So here's a little clip from Joe's Last Jam.
Full and bloody Sweeney Todd tells the story.
Okay. Sweeney Todd, as different than Joe's Last Jam, is one of Sondheim's greatest epics. This is a clip that will give you a look at how strange the material for a musical could be, because what he did was he went back to the 19th century and found one of these painting novels, kind of lurid story about a man who was slicing people's throats when they came in to get shaved, and boy, did he get an amazing shave. And what would happen is, at least in the 19th century, it became a very, very popular melodrama. But Sondheim decided in the 1970s that it was time for Broadway to really look for something totally new. And boy, did he find it. Sweeney Todd is a unique story. If you have an actor like Lynn Carey and someone like Angela Lansbury who can play across from him, this whole situation of him slicing these people to get revenge on the judge who basically took away his wife, he actually doesn't realize that his wife is still alive, living there in London. But he wants to revenge himself on this judge, and he certainly does. Finally, he does get to the judge. But in the meanwhile, a lot of guys who came in for a haircut lose their life. And, of course, the story of him sending the bodies down to Miss Lovett, to make into meat pies is truly 19th century melodrama. That's the kind of things that would be used in the 19th century. So this musical that featured the phenomenal staging of how Prince was a director of musicals who brought something very, very different, very unique. There was this building that was on wheels, and you actually kind of moved it around in the course of the show. That was basically on one side, you see Angela Lansbury's meat pie store, and then up top, you see the chair that Sweeney used to slice his victims. And this would turn with stagehands. That was the other thing how Prince was unique about. He wanted the audience to see what was happening backstage. It was what we call Brechtian. Brecht was a scholar who believed that we shouldn't just be submissive to realism, that we should really give ourselves the chance to see the whole theater, the backstage, the stage managers, the lighting, instruments. And so how Prince did a kind of Brechtian performance here. You see the stage technicians actually moving this huge house around its buildings as he moved. But it made the stagecraft very, very unique. And it was a very blaring, loud play, abrasive in every aspect in terms of the storyline and in terms of how it was actually performed. So Sweeney Todd really set, like West Side Story did in 1960, well, Sweeney Todd in 77, really set a whole new pattern for the American musical. And that's what is very, very unique about the musical, is how many different directions it has gone in. I see Matthew's back in the comments here. Matthew, this is great here. You've got musical abilities as well. I just remember the best musical film ever, The Blues Brothers. It was so good due to the large amount of amazing artists, Betty Waters, Cab Calloway, James Brown, Aretha Franklin, Ray Charles. That's great, Matthew. I just saw a wonderful James Brown section on PBS. Talk about a show, and that is pretty amazing. So that's a great example. And Oscar has the same comment I got from Oscar before. So Chubb's Last Jam was, again, a unique look at the African-American experience, just as Sweeney Todd was a unique idea. Here's Melina Esquivel talking about the High School Musical Counts. I've seen it many times, so good for you, Melina. certainly fits into our pattern here. I think it focuses on status quos and how high schools bring out someone's true identity and can be criticized by other high school students. Yes, the whole phenomenon of high school musical must have something to do with its depth, its focus on contemporary issues. So that serves very well. But if you look at some of the latest musicals like Cats, we were talking about that before, or Evita, this is a musical that was about a political leader in Argentina. It's amazing how many different sources have been there for the American musical. And some of these were by English lyricists as well as composers. But it's an amazing contribution that America has made to the theater world in terms of the American musical. Okay, well, next week we'll join you again. Good luck with your midterm exam. We're going to have to break here, but when we come back next week, we're going to look at playwriting, which is something we've been talking about quite a lot, but we've never really gone into any great depth about it. And we'll also be able to talk about